of Galatians is written because there were a lot of people who did not understand what was actually happening to them in the midst of Galatia. They were being seduced away from their faith, the faith that meant everything to them. It's a lot like America today. We were founded on godly biblical principles, and subsequently we have been overrun by secularism and humanism and evolution and all those things. And we're being drawn away from that which makes the most sense of all things. The more I press the Word of God, the more it makes sense to me. The more I press the Word of God, the more it impresses me because it's amazing. The Bible from the beginning, Genesis to Revelation, is an awesome, awesome book. It's alive. The Bible says it is quick and powerful. It means it's alive, it's powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword. And so as we look at chapter 3, it is in light of the fact that they're being drawn away that the writer writes. So it's very pertinent to you and me. I've entitled the message this morning, The Marks of Conversion. This is something people are struggling with today. They do not understand what it does mean to be born again. There's so much out there. If you were to go to your yellow pages in a phone book and look for churches, you'd find a number of pages, hundreds of churches, and many varieties of ideas. But the Bible is clear on what it is to be a child of God. This is that for which Paul argues, the truth of the gospel. So in verse 1, the Bible says this, of chapter 3, O foolish Galatians, who hath bewitched you that you should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Jesus Christ hath been evidently set forth crucified among you? This only would I learn of you. Received ye the Spirit by the works of the law, or by the hearing of faith? Are you so foolish? Having begun in the Spirit, are ye now made perfect by the flesh? Understand, this is the dynamic right here. Boy, if you were to say what is the most antithetical thing to Christendom, it would be the idea of works salvation. Somebody has made a very good analogy or a connection between the difference between religion and Christianity that's true. You see, true Christianity understands that God has reached for man. But those who are religious think it's man doing everything he can to reach up to get God. We can't reach up to get God. All of our efforts fall short. In fact, the whole concept of that set forth very clearly in the book of Romans. It says we've all sinned and what? Fall short of the glory of God. So every effort you try to put forth to try to get God to like you more is going to fall flat. Because fact is he's got a plan, he's got a way, and if we would just lean in and get our minds around it, he can do what we cannot. He can save us. He can bring us into his family. And that is where we want to be. When it all comes down to the end, we want to be on the right side of things. And the devil is afoot. He's running around trying to make sure everybody misses it. And misses it by a wide margin, hopefully. But if they miss it just by a little bit, he was happy with that. And so what we saw is Paul had defended the gospel in chapter 2. And after he's defended the gospel, he now looks to these Galatians because he had to dress down Peter, who should have known better, but understandably would fall into the rut of his old Jewishness. He had to dress him down. He had to re-explain the gospel to him. But he says to these in Galatia, oh, foolish Galatians, who hath bewitched you? Now, they're Galatians. That means they're Gentiles by nature. So they didn't have this big, huge superstructure of trying to behave, trying to be good, you know, trying to do things God's way because they really didn't even know the true God. They had all the pagan gods. You know, you've heard of those mythologies of the old days? Those were all real religions for those people. Hermes, Aphrodite, Isis, Horus. You go through the litany of them and they all are so far removed from the true God. It's not even anything near it. So he's like, oh, foolish Galatians. And there are a couple of words in the Greek that talk about foolish, used for foolish. This is an interesting one in its own right. This word literally means to not use your understanding. Oh, foolish Galatians. It's not being a moron. There's the word moros. It has the idea that there's dullness of thought. No, he said you're not using your understanding. Now, that's huge because when we talk about the marks of conversion in people's lives, it begins with your understanding. God does not come to you in some kind of a mystical feeling like you get a goosebump and, oh, I'm saved. I remember I had the privilege of leading a young man to the Lord one day, and it was because he had been in church and all these things. And then when I began to investigate and ask him about his salvation, he said this. He said, I know I'm saved because I was at a Christian contemporary concert one day. And I was there, and it was so awesome, and I was caught up in a moment. I had my hands up, and I just cried. And I just knew I was saved. He had no gospel in his heart. He had no understanding. And what I want you to recognize is that people confuse what it is to be a child of God. But it begins with the mind. The Bible says you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. You can't be converted without the knowledge. This is why repentance, being understood properly, is so huge. Because repentance means with the mind. Doesn't mean with the feet. Doesn't mean how you behave. People want to go right to behaving. They want to say repentance means you need to turn your life around. Well, people could really get confused by that, just like the Galatians were being confused. And why were they being confused? Well, they were being confused because they were the new kids on the block, and in came the Jews, and they were saying you needed to keep the law and the feast days. And yeah, you know what? If you really, really want to be really sure you're saved, you want to be circumcised. And that's a huge surgery. And these men in that area were willing to submit to that. That's the measure of their resolve. And so you have to have your knowledge in place. He says you're not using your mind. You're not using your intelligence. God wants you to use your intelligence in salvation. And what I want you to see in this is he actually sets it out here very, very interesting. He says, who has bewitched you? Now, I like that word because it makes us come up short. Like, what? Bewitched? How's that in the Bible? What's bewitched? Well, the word literally has the idea of speaking ill of something. But it goes beyond that. It means to actually bring evil on someone by pretending to praise them. So this word has a depth about it and a nuance. It comes to eventually be applied to people who are charmed or people who are bewitched. Okay, so the idea is if somebody can feather your bonnet enough and tell you how good you are in your religious system, you're going to buy it. Well, after all, they know it. But listen, there's a verse in Scripture that you ought to memorize. If you really want to be careful about all of the nonsense that's out there, there's a verse that really will keep you focused. Let God be true, and every man a liar. Let God be true, and every man a liar. Because the Word of God is where we need to find out where salvation is. Man will tweak, and he will manipulate, and he will change the truth to suit him. And he says, you've not been using your mind. You've allowed yourself to be flattered, if you will, to the point where you were willing to receive something that was not the real thing. Think about that. Who had bewitched you? And it was the Judaizers. Why? New kids on the block, meet the old gang. And the old gang says, yeah, we believe in Jesus. You believe in Jesus. But you need to do this too. Now, that's a problem because Jesus Christ plus anything is not Jesus Christ. It's not. People think they can be saved and then subsequently they're going to somehow make a little effort and really do good. And then as they continue, then they'll be okay. No. 1,000 times. No. It's Christ alone. He died for our sins, according to the Scripture. He set aside any such laws. And he says, you just come and you walk with me. He says, you're not using your mind. He says, you've been bewitched. He says that you should not obey the truth. Now, the word obey oftentimes is the word hupakuo, which means you're not listening under the truth. This one is not that. In fact, this word is the word patho. And that word means to persuade. You're not using the persuasion you have. You don't have what? Conviction. You're letting your convictions slip. Now, we have convictions about some things, right? Everybody has them. Some people have convictions that, right is right and wrong is wrong. And that's a good conviction to have, as long as they've got the Bible as their barometer of what's right and wrong, right? That's good. I've got a conviction. But some people have a conviction that, that the Cleveland Indians are the best team in the world. What you laughing? People have that conviction. Would you laugh? Y'all a bunch of haters. No, no, I know what you're saying. I don't know sports, but I know there's certain things that people have that get, oh, this is so important. They'll break fellowship. They'll stop being your friend if you don't have their conviction about the sports team they love. I remember a man who was so caught up, and I'm just throwing this in there because it's Labor Day. He was a union man, and he worked for General Motors. And his friend came over to visit with him, and he pulled up in a Ford. He pulled up in a Ford, and he parked in his driveway. And when he looked out the window after the guy was in the house for a few minutes, and he saw the Ford, he says, "You need to leave now." I'm like, wow, really? True story. People got convictions. You know, the things that are our truest convictions are the things that define us. He says, how is it that you were bewitched, that you should not obey or have the conviction about the truth you received? You know, when we're children, it's very easy for us to understand the love of God because we're so up close and personal with the love of our parents. They'll do anything for us. They'll throw themselves under the bus. They'll say, take my arm. They'll do whatever they need to do to protect. And I want you to know God did what was necessary to protect us. He sent His only begotten Son to die for us, that whoever would believe in Him would not have to perish, but would have everlasting life. Didn't say whatever would believe in Him and do X, Y, and Z. It said whoever would believe in Him. Why? Because He knew that you and I were so crippled spiritually that we would never be able to achieve or do enough. In fact, the last verse of chapter 2 says, I do not frustrate the grace of God, for if righteousness comes by the law or any law you can conjure, then Christ is dead in vain. That's what he says in chapter 2 and verse 21. He says you stopped using your intelligence. He says what you've done is you've allowed yourself to be solicited because of maybe just wanting to please other people. Or maybe you thought, well, they know something I don't. Let God be true and every man a liar. And he says you're not obeying it. You're not taking your convictions and you're not owning them. And he says in verse 1 further, he says that you should not obey the truth before whose eyes Jesus Christ hath been evidently set forth crucified among you. Now when he talks about it, about the Lord being evidently set forth in their eyes, this is where the word comes again into our minds. I mentioned the word convictions. That's the word obey. Conviction. So our first heading is conviction. This is a mark of a believer. A mark of a believer is he has a conviction about what God did. He has a conviction about Jesus being the one who saves. He has a conviction about it's Christ alone who saves. And there's nothing I can add to it. He has a conviction that salvation is of the Lord. He has that conviction. And one of the reasons he has it is because when he first received his salvation, the Lord came into his soul with power. Now, I don't know how your salvation is, but I know this, that when I come to Christ, when I came to Christ, I came to Christ with a knowledge that I was a sinner. I was a little boy, about 8 or so years old, reading little comic tracts, gospel tracts, and as I read them, every time I read them, the sinner guy was me. And I knew it. You know what's scary today? People don't think they're sinners anymore. You know what's scary today? People are so flooded with the nonsense of the world and the busyness and clamor and the entertainment and all of the things that are so busy. They go to bed exhausted at night. And they've not once thought about eternity or God or how their behavior might be somehow askew. We are indeed in perilous times today. Men are lovers of their own selves, despisers of those that are good. You know, Bible tells us in 2 Timothy chapter 3 that that's the kind of times that we're going to come toward before the Lord comes. It says in Daniel chapter 12 that men will run to and fro and knowledge would increase right before the Lord comes. We have cars, we have planes, and we have internet and we have information. Somebody has well said, it's not today our problem that we don't have enough information. It's we have too much. Sometimes you'll go studying something. I'm going to Google this out. And you'll say, oh, okay, I got that answer. You were content. And then you looked and there was like 1,000 hits below that. And you start, oh, click that and click that. You know, well. And you walk away because it's like overwhelming, like the yellow pages. Where am I going to go to church? I should probably know God. and you end up in some church that's just somewhere out there in la-la land, has no reverence for the Word of God and regard for its truth, and you realize this is just a farce, and you walk away, and you conclude sometimes that that's the way it all is. It's not all like that. Jesus Christ comes with power to the heart that will receive Him. When I would read those tracts, I would always see myself. And you know what? I would pray the prayer at the end of those things every time. I'm 8 years old. I'm not in church. I was collecting these things like baseball cards. I just wondered, is there any more? I want to get some more of those. Because it was so good. Because God resonates with His Word. That's what happens. And He sets Him forth before our eyes as crucified. Now you have to put that in the context. These are Gentiles. These are Gentiles, not Jews. These are Gentiles. When Paul comes into this Gentile region of Galatia, he's preaching a crucified Christ who he declares as Almighty God who gave His life, who being in the form of God, thought it not a thing to be held onto, to be equal with God, but made Himself of no reputation. He took upon Himself the form of a servant and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore God hath also highly exalted Him and given Him a name above every name. Now, I say that out of Philippians chapter 2, and you understand, he was declaring Christ was God, and God died. And they're like, whoa, because all they can think of is these nonsensical Zeus and Mercury and Venus and Athena and Aphrodite and all the nonsense and goddess Diana and you've got all those Ashtaroth and Baals and all that. And they, what? God died? God died for us. Jesus says it in no uncertain terms in Revelation chapter 1, verse 8. He said, I am the Almighty. Isaiah 9:6 says, behold, unto you a child is born. That's Christmas. A son is given. That's crucifixion. And the government shall be upon His shoulders. That's the millennium we're looking for. Beloved, you and I are overwhelmed by stories, just like they were. The problem is, the stories we're getting today of Spider-Man and Iron Man and all that stuff, they're so close to the story of the gospel, because the devil wants it to have a little bit of nuances, you know, good and righteousness, and we're going to defend right, and they're superpowers, and, you know, they can go really fast. And, you know, Jesus appeared in the room. He walked on the water. That doesn't sound like much compared to man. I can fly. I want you to know, Jesus flew. He flew. Bible says when he was giving His last address to the disciples, while they beheld Him, He lifted up from the earth. And as they watched Him, a cloud received Him out of their sight. And these two angels are standing by and say, you men of Galilee, why stand ye here looking up? This same Jesus, which was taken from you, shall so come in like manner as you've seen Him go. But the devil likes to kind of water down and overwhelm the sensibilities. And finally, we don't know what to believe. We fall on our beds at night exhausted. Where's your convictions? What are your convictions? Are you bewitched? Have you been flattered to the point where you say, I'm a good person. Everybody tells me I'm a good person. It doesn't matter what you are. It matters what He is. It matters who Jesus is and who you're trusting. Christ alone saves. And He says your convictions, you've let them fall. You're not using your mind. You're not holding on to your convictions. And you've even seen Him come with power when He was preached to you, a Gentile group. He was set forth before you in power as crucified. A huge deal to get them to accept a God who would be crucified rather than one that would be filled with passions like the Greek gods and Roman gods of their day. He says this in verse 2, this only would I learn of you, received ye the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Convictions. Where did your convictions come from? You know, it's not hard for a child to believe in Christ, because what that child will do is they will believe you as his parent or her parent. And they will receive what you're telling them. And then when they receive that, God will interact with that. That's where you hear the gospel and the Holy Spirit breathes on the gospel. And you're like, yeah, that, wow, I've heard this all my life. But wait a minute, that That, for the first time, I'm really locking into it. Christ died, He was buried, and He rose again the third day. Easter, yeah, I get it. 2016, in the year of our Lord, Anno Domini. Wait a minute. Yeah, He's everywhere. He created it all. The Bible says, in the beginning was the Word. The Word was with God, and the Word was God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. That's Christmas. But He made it all. What I'm saying is, these are like, wait a minute, I'm older now, I'm getting it. Yeah, I know. But as a child, you don't need to be solicited to believe as readily, because as a child, you'll just believe. And God will be all over that. That's why Matthew chapter 18 says it's really huge when one offends the little ones that would believe in Him. He says it's better that they would be have a millstone wrapped around their neck and cast into the deepest sea. Because what happens is once a kid gets a couple wounds, because a couple of wounds, well, God could never forgive that. And boy, I've messed this up. And man, there will never be a way home. And there may never be a way for forgiveness for me. And sadly today, kids are getting wounded at 8 and 9 and 10 years old because of the internet. Parents that are dysfunctional and lives that are falling apart and all of the things that happen. And kids are wounded early. And so now I go to the fair and I talk to children that are 12 years old who are willing to argue with me, the pastor. I'm like, wow, what is going on? Children's hearts are cauterized at a young age because of absenteeism in the parents and in the community and in the society. We've lost our way, but the truth is still the truth. Our convictions are still solid. We have built our house upon the rock. When those winds blow and that storm rages, we will stand because we've built our house upon a rock. He said, did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? The reality is when anybody gets saved, they don't know very much at all. At first, they don't. The Bible says the lost man cannot understand the things of the Spirit because they're carnal. They're spiritually discerned. He can't know them. So when you get saved, of necessity, you won't know much. You won't know much. So it's not like you can say, okay, I worked, and I got saved. No, it can't happen because you don't know what to do. The Bible says, as newborn babes, desire the sincere milk of the Word that we may grow thereby. Why? Because we don't know anything yet. 1 Corinthians says, you are yet babes and not ready for meat, but of milk. He says, you are babes. The word for babes, when he calls them babes in 1 Corinthians, it's the word nepios. I love words because they're so cool. Nepios is a word that we get the word epic from. Epic. Epios. The N at the beginning negates it. You have no words. As a baby, you have no words, he says. And so what he's saying, you have no epic. You have no epic. So you get saved and you don't know everything. So you couldn't have been behaving properly to get saved. You did not get saved by doing good works. You did not get saved by being good. You weren't good. That has to be understood. And when the Holy Spirit comes upon us and the baptism, at salvation, the Bible says we were all baptized by one Spirit into one body and we're all made to drink of one Spirit. That's talking about being placed into the body of Christ. And he says as much later in this chapter. He'll talk about the being baptized into Christ. But right here, he's talking about the Spirit. You might circle the word Spirit because he's talking about how important it is to understand that our convictions were born of the Holy Spirit. In other words, we believed truth by using our mind, and then the Holy Spirit animated that truth in our soul. Ah, let's get out the CAT scan. You ever heard of the CAT scan, right? They take little slices. You want to talk about salvation? The slices, when does it happen? When does it happen? It happens when you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Not when you do better, when you make up your mind to turn over a new leaf. You don't know about anything like that yet. In fact, you don't even know how works factor in here because you've been told, for by grace are you saved through faith and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works. And you're like, well, okay, I don't know all about that, but you said Jesus died for my sins. It's a free gift. He bought and paid for. The gift of God is eternal life. I believe that. It makes sense because I'm a mess. Listen, that's where it starts. And when you believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit comes on that. Because God is everywhere. And the moment someone gets saved, he shows up in their soul. I've had the privilege of leading people to Christ, and right away they'll look up and smile, or sometimes they'll have a tear, or sometimes they'll look scared because they don't know what happened. What just happened just now? I prayed and something happened in my soul. You'll find it's different for each person, how they react. But the Bible says that the Spirit Himself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. That's an experience. The Bible says, if any man has not the Spirit of God, he is none of His. And that's something. So we have this deliberate relationship with God. You and I have that in Ephesians. We want Christ in our souls because we need Him. Now, if I come up to you, and you've been at the fair all day, and I use that just because it's been recent in our days, and you've had cotton candy, and you've had a sausage sandwich. I'm going to mess you all up, aren't I? You know, stay with me. You've had the French fries with a big vinegar on there, and you got salt on them babies, and it's the best thing ever. And I walk up to you, and I say, listen, I've got some cupcakes. You want a cupcake? Oh, I forgot. You were also on the merry-go-round or the Ferris wheel, all that. And now you're like, hey, you want a cupcake? You say, what are you saying? I'm saying that's our world. They've had the cotton candy, and they've had everything they wanted, and anything they wanted at a click of a mouse, they can do and have. Birth control made sex open to everybody, so to this day in which we live, 66 years later, there's nothing off the table now. Everything's open. All the doors are open, all the locks are broken, and nobody has a clue about what's right and wrong anymore. In fact, the only thing they know is right or wrong is that you're wrong if you tell them they're wrong. That's the only value they've got. That's their conviction. They'll get mad at you if you tell them they're wrong. What I'm saying is that when you tell somebody, here's a cupcake, and they're satiated, they're not going to want it, and this is where we are today. People don't think they need Jesus. Number one, they don't think they need Jesus because they think they're okay. Number two, they don't think they need Jesus because they're self-deceived. The Bible says we suppress the truth in unrighteousness. And what that means is that means that what they have is because they've sinned so much, because they've sinned, when you come to them with Christ, right away the devil whispers in their ear and says, if you do that, you'll not be able to do the other thing anymore. Because they're wounded. And they're addicted to their sin. It's not just that they've sinned, it's they're addicted to their sin. They've gone all in, right? And so what I'm saying to you is, they forgot to use their mind. They forgot to obey or what their convictions were there. They forgot that they were not to be bewitched or solicited to evil by others. They forgot how powerfully Christ came when they simply heard about, into their hearts, when they simply heard about Him. You remember Cornelius, he goes and calls for Peter after an angel told him, go call for Peter. Peter comes and he preached to them. And as he's preaching Christ, the Holy Spirit fell on them that moment. Why? Because they believed the moment they heard, oh, that's it. How can they do that? Well, they can do that because he was a God-fearer. He knew about the sacrifices and all that. But now here's the Lamb of God. Here's Jesus, the true Lamb of God, dying for sins. Well, he says, as he's asking the question, did you receive the Spirit by the works of the law or by hearing of faith? Hearing goes to the intellect. Using your mind. Hearing goes to the intellect. Using your mind. You have to understand our sin was so serious that God divested Himself of His glory and He came down here, rolled up His sleeves, pulled out His arms and said, take me. That's the gospel. And if we're so satiated in this generation that we can't hear it, it's because we've been in the carnival. So we've been at the fair. And we don't need it anymore. And that ought to make us very afraid. Because people used to grab hold of rafters in barns where they couldn't preach out in public. And they'd say, God, be merciful, because their sin was so clear in their faces. But we are in a generation of zombies. You know, people are all in that zombie craze. Do you know that everybody who's lost is a zombie? The Bible says, you He has quickened, who were dead in trespasses and sins. We were dead. And you know what we were dead? We were dead. We were not only dead, but we were also, what? Feasting on other people's flesh. If it was through immorality, or if it was through dissembling behavior and licentiousness and just drug use or drinking. We're soliciting everybody. It's feeding on them. We're not caring for their souls from the very earliest days. Abel and Cain, right? Abel did the right thing. Cain did the wrong thing. He was told, do it right. It'll be okay. Just go get yourself a bloody sacrifice. It'll work. He said, no, I'll have none of that. And he slits his throat. He slits his brother's throat. Just like his brother slit the throat of the little animal that he killed to bring to God as a sacrifice. There's much to know, beloved, but it's all good. Because it was all emblematic of what Jesus would do for us. He who knew no sin became sin for us that we might be made the righteousness of God in Him. And when I read this, I tell you, when I was pondering how am I going to preach this, it troubled me. It troubled me because I'm seeing so few people converted with power today. And I had to confront that. Why am I not seeing people get so lit up about God, nothing else will satisfy them like they did in the old days? It's because we're satiated. It's because the devil's afoot. It's because when people get saved, immediately the devil has something very close, but not quite. And there's five of them. I've known people, a number of people actually, who've gotten saved, and within the week, Jehovah's Witnesses were on their doorstep. Or they ran into somebody who was at their workplace that was wrong, or had some other kind of doctrine that was not kind of God's truth. And the Bible says, did you receive it by the works of the law? Or by the hearing of faith. So he's pointing to a specific real thing. This really happened. Did you receive the Spirit by works of the law or by the hearing of faith? Isn't it begged the question, have I received the Holy Spirit? Again, there's an error out there. They say, well, that means you're speaking in tongues, you're rolling in the aisles, and you're foaming at the mouth, whatever. Hey, you say that's being overstated. It is not. You watch some YouTube video of the barking revivals that have come up out of this stuff, and people who are running into walls, and people who are laughing, and people who are laying on the floor in certain kind of epileptic kind of seizures. Listen, there's a whole lot of silliness. No, the Holy Spirit, when He comes into us, He gives joy. Love. In fact, the Bible says the fruit of the Spirit in this book, fruit of the Spirit is love. Didn't say the fruits. The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, gentleness, and so forth. But the love. And I've won people to Christ, the first thing you say, I need to tell my wife this. I need to tell my friend this, my mom, my brother. I need to tell them. Why? Because love. The Bible says the Holy Spirit shed forth His love in our hearts. We care about other people. What's a mark? It's a mark of conviction. And the conviction came with the power of the Holy Spirit. In verse 3, are you so foolish? Same word. Are you so without use of your mind right now, having begun in the Spirit? Because it was a rhetorical question. How did you get started? You got started by hearing of faith, not by works. He says, are you so foolish, not using your mind, having begun in the Spirit? Are you now made perfect by the flesh? In other words, are you now going to help God out? How does that work? If you got saved by believing in Christ, then you're saved. You don't get saved by doing this, 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 and this. You get saved by believing in Christ. And that's how it worked for you. And because they didn't have all that superstructure of Judaism, it was awesome for them. It was great for them. Because when they got saved, it was real to them. Verse 4 tells us the second thing in the continuum, in the marks, among the marks. The second thing among the marks goes from conviction to cooperation. Look at this. In verse 4 it says, have you suffered so many things in vain, if it be yet in vain? I asked you a moment ago to circle the word Spirit because that was his first thing he pointed to. The second thing I want you to circle is the word suffered. Have you suffered so many things? The Bible says, all who will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. You know, when I got saved, I was so reckless I offended people. Imagine that. You know? When you get saved, sometimes you stop doing things because it's like you got other things to do. You got a new life. The Bible says, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creation. Old things are passed away. And behold, all things are become new. And so you've got a new life. I wasn't spending my money on the world's pleasures. I was spending my money by just giving a tithe and thinking, what do I need to do? I went to prayer meeting. Believe it or not, I was 16. I went to prayer meeting. Well, people, I went to prayer meeting. I didn't go because I was trying to wax spiritual. I just realized in my old life, listen, in my old life, I always wondered when the weekend hit, where's the party? Right? Where's the party? When I got saved, I thought, I don't want to go to the party because that'd get me in trouble. That made me feel miserable when I was there. I don't want to go there. And I realized that the church had a party. It was Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday night. Man, there was Sunday school too. Man, when I went to school, we had three times a week in chapel on top of that. By the time I got out of school, I'm like, man, when's church? When are we going to get back? Because I'm lit up. I just needed more. I loved the Word. And I said, the Word was good. The Word was right. The Word was holy and awesome. And I just wanted it. So it didn't matter if I was the only long-haired hippie freak sitting down on the front row with amongst a bunch of old people. I'm going to say amen when they need me to say amen. I'm going to be in church. Why? Because God came with power in my life. And it made me suffer. I lost my friends. I remember after I got right with the Lord and I went to school and I declared it to my friends that it really got real at that point. And when I declared it to them, I did it with all the fortitude of the power of the Spirit. But when I went home that night, I literally collapsed in tears. Just bawling my eyes out. And about 10, 15 minutes into this terrible upheaval of sorrow for a loss, a friend of mine pulled into the driveway from my old life. And he was a friend who came into the house and I blew my nose and wiped my eyes. And I remember that when he sat there, I told him it meant all the world to me that he was there. And that I just had to do it because, and I was able to explain myself. Do you know why I got myself right with the Lord when it came time to? It was because I love my friends more than I love my sin. You see how that works? If I love my friends, I'm not going to do what I was doing, which was telling them this is a legitimate lifestyle. Because I knew it wasn't. Because I had run smack dab into God. You and I love. That's what happens. We cooperate with God. Why? Have you suffered so many things in vain? Verse 4, if it yet be in vain, he therefore that ministereth to you the Spirit and worketh miracles among you, doeth he it by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith? This is his second thing. The first thing was, did you receive the Spirit this way? By hearing or by works? Here he's saying, he that ministereth to you, the Spirit, does he do it by works or because of your faith? Now the word ministereth, you might underline that, put a little note on the side. It actually is a word, it's epikoreigeo. You may hear that word choreograph in there, right? Choreigeo. You might hear, think in terms of antiphonal singing. You know, you ever heard that beautiful stuff? You know, somebody's singing over here and then somebody answers over here, it's beautiful. Choreigeo is that idea. It's to lead a chorus. And what he's saying, it's epi, which means upon. So what happens is, he, verse 5, that therefore, he therefore that ministereth to you the Spirit, worketh miracles among you, doeth he it because of works or because of your hearing of faith. And what he's saying is because you believed God answered it. Choreigeo. God led the chorus. You said yes, and he said amen. Come on. He said, amen. He said, and you're getting more, and you're getting understanding, and there's a word, and there's a stumble, and then there's a recovery. The Bible says the righteous falls 7 times and rises again, but the wicked will fall into mischief. So there is conviction, and there's cooperation. When you respond to God, he baptizes you in the Holy Spirit. When you respond to God, he measures out more of the Holy Spirit. The Bible says we have a relationship with the Spirit that is threefold. We can grieve Him by behavior. We can quench Him by behavior. Or we can be filled with Him. The Bible says, be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, but be filled with the Spirit. Singing and making melody in your heart unto the Lord. Now what I'm saying is that people don't understand how condescending God is. Not only did he let his son die, but he also subjects himself because he says, I will never leave you nor forsake you. That the Holy Spirit is the seal, the guarantee, it's the down payment. We use the word earnest money when we give up money for a house and if we don't go through with it, they get to keep it. He's the earnest of our inheritance. The Holy Spirit is not leaving. That's awesome. And so we can grieve him and we can quench him. You say, well, what does that mean? How does that work? Well, if you're married, you understand what it is to grieve your mate. You understand what it is to rain on their joy, quench whatever's happy for them by maybe making more about yourself. The most miserable thing in the world is to be married when you are quenching and grieving your mate. Because it's like, I just need to be away from them. And that's how you will feel with God. The funny thing is, God ain't leaving. So if you're running over here and you're all miserable, He's right there. Every time you turn around, you bump into Him because He's so good. He's so good. But when you do the right, you're filled with the Holy Spirit. How does the Holy Spirit work? He fills us. The Bible says that He works miracles among you. You say, well, what's that all about? Well, in that day, of course, there were the apostolic miracles. The apostolic miracles. The Bible says that God gave Christ, and then when Christ ascended, He gave gifts to the apostles, and there was some tongue speaking, and they were not gibberish, it was languages. Acts chapter 2 is very clear. These were foreign languages. People were saying, we hear every man speaking in our own language. That was the miracle. Tongues are not gibberish. It's not as the heathen do, batalagia, which is bada, 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 bada. It was a word that says they were just saying gibberish. That's what the heathen did, even totally unrelated to God. In their sensual feasts, they would get so ecstatic, their tongues would go crazy, and they would call that speaking in tongues. You see, we have a lot to battle today because there's so many nonsensical viewpoints of things. The Bible's very clear. He worked miracles among them. Not only was there the miracle of the apostolic variety, but there's also the miracles of the application of the truth. First Thessalonians, you might write this in your margin by that verse. First Thessalonians is a book written to the Thessalonian believers, and they were so lit up about God that it was obvious to all they were God's children. And this is what he says to them in verse 4 and following. He says, we know your election, for the gospel came to you in power and in the Holy Spirit. First thing, conviction, Holy Spirit, right there, bam, conviction. Same thing he's saying happened in Galatians. He says, the Holy Spirit came, or the gospel came with power and in the Holy Spirit. He says, and it came with much assurance. There's your conviction. He says, and you became followers of us, mimics of the believers that were really getting it right. And he says, and you endured much affliction. There's your suffering. And he says, and you became examples. In other words, you became people other people wanted to emulate. And then he says, not only that, but you turned to God and from idols to serve the living God and to wait for His Son from heaven. You know, we are so far removed from our Bibles today, we don't even wait for our God from heaven today. I want you to know, I'm waiting for God. I think He's coming, and I think it ain't going to be long. And I think when it starts raining, like in the days of Noah, if you will, to use it as an emblem, I want you to know the doors are going to be shut, and people are going to be screaming in terror. The rapture occurs, Christ takes us out, and then He pours out His wrath on this world, and they go to the rocks and the hills. And rather than to pray to God because they're so dark, they cry to the rocks, fall on us. And what's interesting is it says they cry to the rocks, fall on us, for the day of the wrath of the Lamb is come. I guess there's a new TV series out. It's called Exorcist. There's one that came out a couple years ago called Lucifer. We are so overwhelmed. We're the frog in the kettle, beloved. It got hotter and hotter and hotter and hotter, and we were like in there when it was cold. And now it's so hot and we're dying in here because we don't have any scruples to what's happening. But it's out there, and they make sport of what is so serious. He says, did you receive it by the hearing, by the works of the law, or by the hearing of faith, even as Abraham believed God and it was accounted to him for righteousness, in verse 6. The question mark could be moved from the end of verse 5 to the end of verse 6 because it's part of the question. He says, did you receive it by the hearing of faith, even as Abraham did? See, that's the point. He's trying to get us back to Abraham. Abraham predated the law by 430 years. There was no law. None. Wasn't any Ten Commandments. Moses wasn't even born yet. Abraham had no kids yet. And he received this promise. And he believed God. And the Bible says, because he believed God, it was imputed to him for righteousness. Use your mind. How cool is that? Because it doesn't say he believed in God and it was imputed, because everybody believed in God. The devil believes in God. It says he believed God. And so because he believed in God, it was imputed. Or because he believed God, it was imputed unto him for righteousness. You see, people don't take God at His word because they don't know His word. And when they hear His word, it just kind of goes into a prismatic kind of a scenario where they can't get their clarity back and they can't get their minds around it because they're so overwhelmed with so many nonsensical ideas, like that we came from a primordial ooze. I'm sorry, it's troubling. I really, really am troubled by it. He says, that's how you received it. It's through the cooperation of God. You believed and God showed up. You believed and God animated it. You believed and your life changed. You didn't change your life. He changed your life. If you thought your house was on fire, you'd be out of here. If you have a loved one somewhere and you got a phone call or a text that said that they were in a bad accident, your heart would be up. You'd be running. I got to go. See, we're overwhelmed. We don't want the cupcake because we're sick. And so we deny it. We get used to denying it. And then what happens is when somebody tells us the truth, we hear it and we dismiss it because we think it's too late for me. And that's the devil's lie. It's never too late. God waits. Take Manasseh in the Old Testament. Beautiful, powerful, powerful, powerful story. Reigned longer than any other king in Israel. He was 65 years on the throne. He was the most wicked king who ever lived. Ever. He did child sacrifice in the temple, for crying out loud. Child sacrifice. When he was carried away by the Babylonians, he hung in stocks on the wall of a dungeon. He said, oh God, I'm sorry. And God said, come on over here and let me give you a hug. And he forgave him. And he restored him. And he couldn't pull back the nasty he had set loose, but he got forgiven. Beloved, you've never gone too far. As long as there's breath, there's hope. The only people who've gone too far are those who've not made a decision and have perished in that condition. Verse 7 says, know ye therefore that they which are of faith, the same are the children of Abraham. He's telling these Gentiles that they're the real children of Abraham. And you say, what? Because Isaac was a child of promise. His name means laughter. 90-year-old Sarah had a baby with 100-year-old Abraham. Shouldn't happen. So they called him laughter. What is going on? This is crazy. I'm a 90-year-old woman having a baby. Laughter. Why? Why? Because they were children of promise just like Gentiles are children of promise. We're children of Abraham. And the Bible says in verse 8, and the scripture, circle it, scripture. So you have cooperation. Now you have connections. Because after you get saved, you have no nepios. You're a babe. You have no words. Now you get some words. This is cool. And the connections are there. And he's beginning to make this connection that the scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the heathen through faith, preached the gospel before unto Abraham, saying, in thee shall all the nations be blessed. And so they that are of faith are blessed with faithful Abraham. Put in your margin for the word blessed. Eulogy. Eulogy, eulogeo, it's the word eulogy. We speak well of Abraham to this day because Abraham put the ball on the tee, showed us what real saving faith looked like, and then subsequently, he showed us how we needed to accept God too. It's by faith alone. We need to believe God. If God says this, whoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. You may be in a framework where you don't need a cupcake. You're full. You're good. I've figured it out. It's all about my good outweighing my bad. If that's where you're at, fine. But I'm telling you this, that ain't it. Every work of law will disappoint because you will not even keep the law you erect for yourself. Oh, we'll live together. We'll do this. We'll do that. And when it falls apart, they just go on because even though their little house of cards fell apart, they say, well, that doesn't mean anything. And they've messed up their own law. We can do this. We can handle this. You cannot. We have to do it God's way. We are saved to live unto God, he says in verse 19 of chapter 2. And we live unto God because we want to. People who don't want God won't want the gospel. But people who need God, know they're sinners, hear the words, whoever will call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. And they say, could it be? Would me too? Yeah, I'm glad it didn't say, if Dave shall call upon it, because all y'all be in trouble. You have to change your name. It said, whoever shall call. If you'll call, you'll be saved. That's what it says. So if I believe God, that's huge. That's not foolish. That is using your mind. Let God be true and every man a liar. So he says the scripture foreseeing it, preached it. Verse 9 says, so they that are of the faith are of faith are blessed with faithful Abraham. So not only was he eulogized, but we who believe truly that it's Christ alone only, without works and all that, we're going to be eulogized by God and by men. Because people will say, why is it they're not freaking out? The world's coming to an end. We're not freaking out because we're excited. We get to go home. We'll do what we can while we're here. It makes us think, yeah, I need to tell somebody, man. They're going to get saved. That's the love that part moving. But I'm not freaking out because of the elections that are coming up. I'm grieved by them. I'm like those in Zechariah who sighed and cried. It makes my heart bleed because I love my country. But I love my heavenly citizenship more. We seek a city whose builder and maker is God. And we declare it plainly by our behavior. And are therefore eulogeo. He says, for as many, verse 10, as of the works are under a curse. So whether it's the works of the law or works of a law you've particularly set up, you're going to fail that. You've met people who bargained with God. God, I'll do this if you'll do that. We all did it. I remember this little boy. He said, you know what? I was told I need to be good. I need to be good or I won't get any good things for Christmas. And I want a bike for Christmas. So he thought about that. Okay, I'll be really, 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 really good. He's trying to be good. He thought, man, this is hard being good, man. It's only October. I got to be good. So he got an idea. He went next door and he stole the lady next door. He stole her statue of Mary. And he hid it under his bed. And he got down under his knees and he said, dear God, I want a bike really bad. And I got your mom under the bed. If you want her back, you'll give me my bike. Being good's not all it's cracked up for, right? You know, I got your mom under the bed. I'm saying, you know, we do. We figure out a way. And we say, well, this ain't working. So we change and we adjust. I had to wake you guys back up. I saw it going. See, it says, verse 10, many as are of the works of the law are under a curse. You'll be under a curse. He was under a curse. The word curse keeps coming up. And so there's a connection that happens. You begin to get the word and there's, oh, okay, now I see even more than I saw when I first believed. And then finally there's a continuance. The Bible says in verse 11, but that no man is justified by the law in the sight of God. It is evident, for the just shall live by faith. He said it over and over again. The word live is our connection with continuance. We live by faith. If you don't live by faith, you're probably stumbling along. Because you're thinking, wow, man, I've blown it and I've messed up. And you don't understand. He knew you would. The Bible says it's of the Lord's mercies that we're not consumed right now. But the steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning, praise God. And the more you get the Word of God in your core, the more the connections are made and the more the continuance is facilitated. Salvation is not about being good. It's about being Christ's. Nothing in my hands I bring. Simply to the cross I cling. He says, you will live by faith. Or you'll be under the curse. Verse 12 says, but the law is not of faith. The man that doeth them shall live in them. Verse 13, Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, being made a curse for us. For it is written, cursed is everyone who hangs upon a tree. Jesus was the lightning rod. Jesus was the one who paid our sin debt. Jesus was the one who gave himself for our sins. And we trust Him alone. We get in by grace. He loved us so much that He gave Himself in our behalf. Somebody had to pay for our nonsense. Somebody had to pay for our sin. Jesus paid for our sin. And it may be months, maybe years, in the continuum we see here that are set before us, of conviction, where we first got it, cooperation, where we felt God show up when we believed it. We got the connection, if you will, that the scriptures made some sense, but we didn't have many. The devil sidelined us, and there may be months or even years that go by when people are saying, you know what, I prayed when I was 10, but I've been such a rascal, I've been such a bad, bad, bad person. I was talking to a girl, a lady one day, who was just, looked like had many miles of bad roads. She was rough-looking lady. And when I was talking to her, trying to share with her that we'd love to have her come to the church, there was a point where she was just you could just see her heart was broken over her life, how it had been. She's a much older lady. But the moment I mentioned church, literally a toothless smile, and that little girl showed up. My mama used to take me to church. And she was just... no teeth. And she was immediately 12 years old again. Years had gone by. Debris had been heaped on, but she didn't have many words. She didn't have the steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. The Spirit of God says, is the earnest of our expectation. She didn't hear Jesus say, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. She didn't know. And she was bewitched. And she had very little conviction as the year had gone by. But Jesus redeemed us from the curse of the law, becoming a curse for us. He was hung upon a tree. And finally, verse 14 says that the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. We will continue when we know Him. Marks of a conversion, the conviction of the Spirit, the cooperation of God when we receive Him, the connections of the Scriptures as we go along and the continuance because we get it. And as we continue. Now, some of these marks may not be present right now in your life because you're still stumbling off to number 2, number 3, number 4. You're in the middle of... The devil's been hammering you. You didn't realize you needed to run back to church and get some more truth. You needed to turn on the right kind of music and the right kind of verbiage and the right kind of teaching because what you had was you had only yourself to go by and you didn't know anything. The family wasn't there or the parents weren't taking you and the wolves were all over your case because the devil doesn't care about you so much when you're lost. But the moment you raise your head from the crowd and start doing the right, he sends in his troops. And you wonder what in the world happened to you. Beloved, I don't know where you are today, but I know this. God loves you more than you could possibly imagine. All of us have no clue how awesome it's going to be. The Bible says, eye hath not seen, ear hath not heard, neither has it entered into the heart of man the things that God has prepared for them that love Him. I love Him today, and I hope you do too. But if you don't know you're saved today, you can. You need to believe God. Whoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son that whoever would believe in Him would not perish, but would have everlasting life. The next verse says, for God sent not His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved. Do you want Him today to save you? Let's bow together.